Hey, history buffs. Welcome to another edition of Anarchast, your home for anarchy on the internet. I have another great guest. It's just one after another lately. Richard Grove of tragedyandhope.com. For those of you who don't know him, he's a forensic historian, and he's really been looking back at many events throughout history and taking a new look at them because, as we all know, but probably not as well as Richard, most of the stuff they teach you in the history books is not exactly 100% all the truth and the only way you can look at how these events played out. So we're going to talk a lot about history and a number of things. But first, though, I have to ask you the number one question I have to ask everybody is, how did you become an anarchist?
Well, thank you for inviting me on the show, Jeff. I really never thought of myself as an anarchist until you sent that email. I said, well, I definitely fall under a lot of the same beliefs because I think that it starts with understanding the difference between right and wrong. And then from there, understanding that all forms of human slavery are wrong. And anarchist means, or it comes from the word anarchos, which means without rulers. So if you're self-responsible and self-reliant, it seems natural that you wouldn't need to be ruled or managed or have a master. So I went down my own path of looking into what is the nature of obedience to authority and who am I as a person. And I think it naturally takes you down this progression where you own yourself, or you discover you own yourself after many years of being told you don't. And because of that, you have new freedom. You have to own yourself intellectually and physically. So there's intellectual self-defense and physical self-defense necessary to be without rulers. In history, there's an idea called Swaraj that comes from India, which means self-rule or self-reign. So it's the same idea that if you're an adult and you're responsible, you shouldn't need any rulers to tell you what to do.
Yeah, absolutely. I just saw you in a great, you're at Porkfest. I might ask you about that, if that was your first time. And you were talking with Luke Radowski, another good friend of mine. And you were telling him a story about how you used to be just working a regular job, what happened at 9/11, and that made you look into everything. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about what happened there.
Well, sure. Like I said, it doesn't all happen at once, but 9/11 was a very traumatic day. I used to work in New York City on Wall Street, and my clients were the world's largest financial services companies, and I was selling them software. So I was getting intimate behind the scenes, you know, access and understanding of their designs of their systems prior to them ever rolling out to the public. Sometime after 9/11, I discovered that all this corruption isn't just happenstance. It's not accidental, that there seems to be a systematization behind it because it's very profitable. And after going through court and after blowing the whistle in 2003 and going to court and representing myself in court pro se, which was quite an interesting process, I discovered that even if you present the evidence over a 3-day trial in court, the judge can still act like that evidence was never presented and decide against you. And then I went to the media and I thought, well, surely people want to know because they're going to be taken advantage of through this backdoor in the software that I had identified. And this could lead to a great financial calamity where all these companies can be taken advantage of without the companies themselves even knowing what's going on because of the backdoor in the mandated software. So as I discovered that the media wasn't there to warn the people, they were kind of there to just steer people in the direction where they're going to get fleeced. And that's how the behind the scenes kind of works on that. So since then, I discovered, through that process that the history map that I was given in school does not fit how the world actually works. And that before I go making any other serious decisions in life, I should take some serious time and invest in learning what the history is for myself so I can have an accurate map to this terrain. So I'm not taken advantage of as easily. That's what I refer to as intellectual self-defense, the ability to use a question mark and not just assume that what you're being spoon-fed by media or schooling is accurate. So after going through that process a couple years, I started to create media, and that's what I've been doing for the past 10 years.
That's great. And so looking at the history that you've been uncovering, what would you say to people has been sort of the most shocking things that you've sort of uncovered that most people don't know about?
Well, I think a lot of people know about the Federal Reserve and how it's not federal and it doesn't have a reserve, and that the fix is in on that. People know about the bankers. What most people weren't aware of, at least until the past 10 years, and a lot of this is made possible because of the internet, is that there's a great set of books by Dr. Antony Sutton, who used to work for the Stanford Institute for Research into Peace and Revolution. Until he discovered the trilateral group, and then he got fired because his boss, David Hewlett, I think, of Hewlett Packard, or maybe it was David Packard, was a trilateral. So Sutton then starts to, as a whistleblower, look into the sordid history of the people that he was working under and kind of idolized in the academic establishment. And what his books portray is a mosaic going from the Federal Reserve to the fixing of gold prices to how Wall Street funded, Wall Street and Bolshevik Revolution, Wall Street and FDR, and Wall Street and Hitler are the books. But basically, he shows you that World War II, you know, these bad guys, the Nazis, were being funded by the same people who were funding the United States and the British. And then from World War II, those same bankers were funding the other side on the Cold War and providing military hardware and technology through the Cold War. And then into Vietnam, where the people that we're fighting in Vietnam are being armed with the same Western technology that we're using to fight them. So I discovered this ominous continuity of this undercurrent of history that is very real, very valid, written about by very scholarly and professional academics. It's out there in the open. It's not a conspiracy. It's just that these books are not advertised to you on the New York Times bestseller list. They're not advertised to you on Oprah. But they're very much out there, and they give you a much more accurate and easily understandable picture of history than is affordably produced by any university on the planet, because most of the universities have been inculcated into this intelligence apparatus that is right now like weaving a web around the planet where nobody's going to have freedom if their plans aren't at least realized and measures taken for people to get their freedom back and their privacy back.
Yeah, and one of the reasons we know about the Federal Reserve, or a lot of people do now, whereas 10 or 20 years ago, hardly anyone even knew what it was or that it even existed, which is quite shocking because it's on every dollar bill in the U.S. But a few episodes ago, we had G. Edward Griffin on, who wrote The Creature from Jekyll Island, so he did an excellent job of showing how that all came together.
Well, and I've interviewed Ed before. He's a very, very interesting cat. If you check out his video from 1968 on globalization and collectivism, I mean, his work's been fantastic for many, many decades. I was in a film with him a couple years ago, State of Mind, The Psychology of Control. So if you like G. Edward Griffin, that's something cool to check out. And the other favorite of mine that he did was an interview with this cat named Norman Dodd. Do you know about Norman Dodd?
Of the Dodd Act or whatever?
Well, he's part of the Reese Committee, and it was an investigation into these nonprofit foundations, the Rockefeller, Ford, and Carnegie foundations, and their influence on American education systems starting back at the turn of the century, in the 20th century. So there was this whole commission to figure out what the influence of these organizations were on our schooling system and thus on our children. And Dodd has this meeting, and G. Edward Griffin is one of the people that inspired me to do interviews, because this is a nugget that he captured back in 1981 that is still today not widely understood by most Americans. And that is this, that the purpose of those foundations was to change the attitudes, values, behaviors, and beliefs of Americans so that we could be merged with the Soviet Union system of government. And Soviet means rule by council. So it's no longer truth is something objective. It's truth is what the strong people say it is. It's solipsism, and it's the opposite of objective truth. And that's something that if we're going to have freedom, there is a direct relationship between freedom and truth. And as we lose our connection to truth, thus goes freedom.
Yeah, absolutely. So many things to think about what's really going on and discovering all these things. It's as you know, it could take up a lot of your time.
Well, I made it the full-time job. I mean, after a couple years of digging in to see, because when you first come into contact with these ideas, I mean, I can't even picture myself working in a cubicle like I used to, but, you know, I picture somebody working in a cubicle where you're, you know, in an environment that's a corporate environment, and you might hear about some of these things and you think, that's impossible. That's crazy. Well, I encourage you, next time you hear some of these things, just check them out. Use the Google. Like back in the day, I didn't really have a whole lot of internet experience, even though I worked in technology and I sold a lot of software. I wasn't a heavy user of the internet. I wasn't an early adopter of it. When the Silk Road went on, I didn't even know about the Silk Road until after Ross got busted. So I'm not the early adopter of technology. And, to break through to somebody who's in that corporate environment, I think it just takes that splinter in the mind. And that it's that thing that says, wait a minute, there's this financial family called the Rothschilds, and they're, you know, hundreds of years old, and they have a lot of power. Well, when I first heard that, I thought that's some internet rumor. There's no substantiation to it. Surely at my 5 years of, you know, university, they would have told me about this. Well, on page 52 of his book, Tragedy and Hope, Professor Carol Quigley says, you know, here's this family, and they've wielded power over politicians and governments and fought, like, funded both sides of wars for centuries. And I said, well, that can't be true. But this book was written in 1966. So, you know, maybe this guy knows what he's talking about. Let me look and see if there's anything else. Over the past 10 years, I've acquired like 50 books that are their biographies, autobiographies, books sanctioned by the families. And then it connects into other, you know, banker families like the Warburgs and so on. But when you see who is at the pinnacle of this, it's definitely a family that I think deserves more mention in America, because when you look into some of the root causes of the financial calamities that we've had, the political fixes, I mean, we're almost into a choice of monarchy here again. Which ruler from the ruling family, is it going to be the white rose or the red roses? You know, and so I think we've adopted a lot of British culture over the past 100 years, you know, really over the last 100 years, post-Civil War, where we no longer identify ourselves as the people who decided that all men are created equal and women too. People of all races, colors, and creed have the same rights. Now, our government might not have realized it yet, but once individuals realize this, then things won't be so divide and conquer. And the way that the attitudes, values, and behaviors and beliefs of Americans were changed over the 20th century, when you trace the funding for these different organizations and projects and working groups, they have a common source. And so I became very interested in acquiring every practical piece that really illustrated the different pieces in this mosaic, so that eventually I would not only preserve these very valuable books, but I'd also be able to introduce them to people who maybe couldn't afford them or don't have the inclination to seek out hard to find books, to be able to let the story be told in the voices of the people who wrote it, the people who are writing the script for everybody today who doesn't think for themselves. You know, I recently did a t-shirt design that was, I know it's cliche to do the keep calm and, you know, but that's a famous piece of art from British war history that was never used during World War II and only surfaced, you know, in this past decade, I think. So I made one that says, keep calm and start thinking. And I turned the crown upside down. So I don't have to say anarchy. I can just say, look, without rulers, keep calm and start thinking. That's the answer. You know, freedom's the answer. What's the question is what Ernie says. I say learning's the answer, and what's the question? And once you ask the question, that starts us all down the road to freedom.
Yeah, and as you pointed out, they have been doing this. It's been a plan. You just had John Taylor Gatto on in the last year or two on your show, I believe, and I was watching that. It was really good. If for people who don't know John Taylor Gatto, amazing guy, used to work in the New York public school system and then realized what a total sham it is, how they're just basically training people to memorize data and to come in at 9 and leave at 5 and be good little drone workers or prepare them for jail, really, in the other sense too. And so, yeah, this has been sort of planned. And so a lot of people, mostly in the U.S., although it's in other parts of the world as well, but usually not as bad, is they just don't have the capability to even think about things. They've just been taught their whole life that they're just supposed to memorize what's on the screen in front of them at night, or what's in the book in front of them at their public indoctrination camp.
That's not a culture that is inspiring to freedom at all. And the reason that I hunted John Taylor Gatto down over about 2 years. It took me to get that interview. The reason that I was so interested is because I had read his book, The Underground History of American Education, in about maybe 2004. I think he published it in 2001. So a couple years after it came out, people were like, this book has all the answers. I read it. I couldn't make heads or tails of it. 4 years later, I went back and reread that book. I was like, holy, this guy figured it all out, and he mapped it out, and he's explaining piece by piece how they did it. So it went from something I couldn't understand its value to having enough context after a couple more years of learning for myself to be like, wow, I totally couldn't see it because I was so schooled. And he writes in a poetic way. It's prose, but he is a master of prose. And he's able to tell you a good story that's all based on all, like hundreds of books that he has read and referenced. And there's footnotes, even though they're not in a book. He doesn't believe in including footnotes because he's against the academic culture that they've created. But he has all the references for this. And so many of us have dug into those references, and it's very substantial what he's laying out there. And so when I interviewed him over 2 days. It's about a 5.5 hour interview. But what parents can get is this man went to the top private schools, figured out what makes their kids successful. What kind of curriculum are they getting? What kind of preparatory education are they getting? And then he created these books that basically give it out to everybody. So that his class was about teaching his kids to think for themselves and how to access people in various institutions by learning about the history of these institutions. They used them as an example of why the schooling system was successful. And then they started bringing people around, and he's like, I couldn't have people seeing how I was actually teaching, because he was letting kids go out into the city and interact with other adults and question somebody who owns a business and collect some information and put together a report, actual investigative journalism in some cases, things that led to things like the Imagine Mosaic in Strawberry Fields in New York City's Central Park. That was put there because his kids went to the appropriate people in New York and got approval after Yoko Ono couldn't get it done. So there's a lot of history to be learned from reading through his books. He's a miraculous teacher in my consideration, because he not only survived that school system, but he's used his decades after that to write some prolific works about how we've been undermined intellectually in this country. And they attack the youngest among us when they go after children in these schooling systems and systematizing it in such a way that takes away their freedom and their liberty and their volition. So that was my bit on John for today.
Yeah, it was Vladimir Lenin who said that if you give me your child for 4 years, the seed I plant will never be uprooted. So it's crazy to be sending your kids to these public schools, especially now they want them in kindergarten. They're like 2 years old now. So they've got to their minds are like so easily molded at that age. It's very dangerous to send your children to these places, in my opinion. I've even called it child abuse to send your kids to public school. And interesting that you pointed out, though, that when you first read Gatto's book, it didn't really mean much to you. And part of the reason that might be, and I've had that happen in my life, too. I read a book and I was like, what's this book about? I don't really get it. And then 5 or 10 years later, it'll come back around and maybe I should just take a look at that again. And then, now I understand. So it's a process of sort of connecting the dots and figuring out what's going on. So some people might not be able to receive this information, like Gatto's book. They might be like you when the first time and go, I don't get what that means, because they don't have enough dots connecting, and they've got so much propaganda in their heads at the same time, just thinking, well, you got to get your high school diploma and just got to do that. That's just the way it is. You got to send them to government schools, and so it takes a while for people to sort of open up to these sort of things sometimes.
Well, and I think it's also because of how our schooling system is set up. And just for an example, a teacher is teaching from a textbook. The textbook isn't made up of sentences with a bunch of question marks. In most cases, if you want to learn about any given piece of history, let's say, it's going to be a bunch of declarative sentences. A declarative sentence says you've gone through a process of reasoning from something that exists, and you've come to a conclusion or a decision or a judgment or a statement. So if you're making a declarative statement, this is how it is. That tells the child, you don't ever need to ask a question about George Washington and the cherry tree, because you just saw it there with a declarative sentence. Next declarative sentence, right? And then 48 minutes later or whatever, here comes Pavlov's bell to break up your learning. And in the past 10 years, I've done so much more learning than I ever did in school. I didn't do it because anyone told me to do it. I didn't do it because anyone's paying me to do it. I did it because I have an interest to figure out how this world works. If I seek for my decisions, they actually have the causality that I'm seeking for them to have. I need an accurate map of the terrain. And I need to map these different substantial pieces of evidence and artifacts into an understandable and translatable map that I can share with other people, that they can see it and say, no, I think this piece is over here. When I was over there, I looked like this. And so it's only through, taking a step, having communication and improving ourselves all the time. But you can't do that. You won't do that if you assume you know everything. And I went through corporate world, having come out of university and being fortunate enough, because I was an entrepreneur and I had started my own business, that came from self-reliance and self-esteem and self-confidence that I had earned through doing things. Because I had taught myself how to run my own business, it was easy to get a job in corporate sales. Once I'm in corporate sales and I'm making a bunch of money, I don't really need to ask questions anymore. The money tells me I'm right and that I'm just supposed to spend it like they say in the magazines and do like this. This is what people like you do. So it goes from not thinking at all, really, just making assumptions and basing everything upon another assumption, to having buildings blow up and you survive that event. Because I was a couple blocks away when 9/11 happened, and I was driving up to it as smoke's pouring out of World Trade Center 1. So after a day like that, when you see things that you've never been prepared for, that you're not prepared to, take in acts of terrorism in America with buildings blowing up like that, that really makes you start to take a step back. I would say questioning really that day started during the event, and then when 20 acres of concrete disappeared and turned into dust in like 20 seconds. Those types of things, you don't realize it right away, but your mind starts saying, hey, does that seem right to you? Maybe we should look into this. So who were the smartest people? Were they looking into this? Oh, they're, when you read the 9/11 report that came out July 22nd, 2002 or 3 or something like that. I read that the day it came out, and I was like, whoa, they missed the whole thing. And then you discover it's like they're not supposed to find out what's going on. They're not supposed to follow up on the real leads. And then that makes you go back and study something like the Warren Commission, and other, Iran-Contra Commission, BCCI, other historical, the Rockefeller Commission, the Church Commission, the Reese Committee, the Pujo hearings, all these different places in American history where serious decisions were being made against our freedom. But it goes on under the guise of an investigation that never really leads to the action that it claimed to take in the first place.
Yeah, we just had Oli Damagard on recently on Anarchast as well, and he was saying a lot about how the committees that come in to find out what happened, it's always a setup. It's usually the same guys, and they just whitewash everything. But it's amazing, though. Like I call a lot of people brainwashed slaves, and some people might take that as I'm being a little mean or a little cocky or something. But really, a lot of them are. First, they're slaves, of course, because they want a ruler or they have a ruler. But secondly, they're brainwashed. It's amazing. Like this, it's been so shocking to me to see how they literally can't see something that's right in front of their face. They're that brainwashed. So, for example, you could say, with 9/11, with that plane that was in the field in Pennsylvania, I was sitting there and they went, oh, here's the plane. And I'm looking, I'm like, that's like a small little garbage fire. Where's the plane? Everyone's like, yeah, that's the plane. And then some troublemakers like Luke Radowski and all these people started saying all the things that they thought happened. And one of the things that I was always saying back then, before I even looked into it too much, and now I'm almost an expert level on it, I've looked into it so much, but I was focusing on the what happened at the Pentagram. I was like, how did that giant jet go into that little hole? And I kept saying that. And I was actually at an airport in the U.S. and CNN was on, of course. And the woman comes on. She goes, "They've finally released the video of the plane hitting the Pentagram." And I was like, no way. I was like, unbelievable. And she goes, "They've only given us 3 frames, but it is 100% proof that a plane hit the Pentagram." And there's like nothing. And there's a frame with like a little bit of smoke. And then there's an explosion. And I was like looking at the screen. I looked at everyone in the airport to see if anyone would go like, "Where's the plane?" And I heard everyone around me all like nodding and saying, "You see, those guys are crazy. They think there was no plane. They just showed it on TV. So there's a plane." It's like, they didn't show a plane. Like they can't see. They're blind. They're brainwashed.
Well, I think that by brainwashed, you could there say those people are assuming and they haven't yet looked for themselves. Because the fact that someone had to tell you it was a plane, if someone just showed you those 3 frames and said, "Can you identify what that is?" I don't think anybody could with any validity. You can't see a tail number. You can't see you can't see serial numbers. You don't have transponder numbers. It's not a radar signature. It's a blur. Whatever's on there is a blur. And that's the absence of identification, which means it's not the end point for learning. It's a starting point for learning. And a starting point for learning would be collect all the photographic and video evidence of the Pentagon that day. If you look at in the first 10 or 15 minutes, the aspects that are affected on the accounting department of the Pentagon, where a day before they claimed to have lost $2.3 trillion. That's the part that blew up, that had just been reinforced with special bomb proof, missile proof type stuff that they probably needed to test. And there's an effective area. So if you look at it, when the building starts to crush in, there's a clean shear on this side over here, and there's a book on a pedestal that hasn't been burned or singed or anything. It's one of the strangest looking disaster scenes I've ever seen. Except I could go to Flight 93. There's an interesting scene. I don't know that who identified Flight 93 at any point during the day? Were there drills going on? Is it possible these things are identified falsely? Yes, it is. There was tons of military drills going on that day. There is no evidence of a plane crash in Pennsylvania. Yes, there is some smoldering stuff. And when you take a really good look at that stuff, it doesn't add up to plane crash. So again, it's the absence of identification that is taken under the non-thinking, unconscious motivation of assumption that you already have the truth and you don't need to look. And that's how they're taking our freedom. That's how they pull off psychological warfare, like what you see on 9/11 or the 7/7 bombing or any of these other drills that, you know, Jade Helm started today. And it's mostly about them mapping the human domain and how we react to them trying to take away our freedom. They're just mapping that out, and they're going to let the Skynet AI drones deal with it at some point. I mean, look up autonomous killer robots. Who do you think they're building that stuff for? Not necessarily people on the other side of the world, because the people who are the leaders in freedom on the forefront able to do something are we in this country, in America at least, who are still paying tax dollars to this behemoth that is doing everything in our name, but not listening to anything we say. So when there's no causal, you know, cause and effect between you voting and what the government's doing, and there's a recent Princeton report that came out on this, which is very telling, says there's no causal relationship between the will of the people and the actions of the government. These are things that we should really consider for ourselves. I think the last time I voted was 2004. This year I'm going to vote for nobody. I think that's what everyone should do. You vote for nobody, then you can at least have a chance at winning. Why should we be voting to put other people in cages? I think the most brilliant recent articulation I've heard of that case against the state is Larkin Rose. You know, if you're able to get somebody to read that book without having an emotional reaction and calling you names, you might break through. Or Adam Kokesh's recent book, Freedom. There's a 100-page book that's like the common sense of our day. You know, and when you look at the founding fathers and the literature that brought about the American Revolution against the British, and then you look at our position with the British today, where we are worshiping British royalty in our country, like it's our royalty, and then people are okay with two dynastic American, you know, establishment families just sending more of their kids to go be president.
Yeah, I think a big part of going back a little bit to brainwashing a little bit, a big part of it is also fear, because I've obviously had thousands of conversations where I'm trying to explain things to people, whether it be what you were saying about how the banking system works or 9/11. For example, when you're talking about the plane that wasn't in Pennsylvania, I'll say that to a lot of people. I'll say, look at this photo and look at the coroner. He said there was nothing for him to do there. There was no bodies. And I actually see a little switch go off in their brain, and it goes to this fear mode, because I know what's going to in their brain in that moment. It's like, well, if the plane's not there, where is it? And that's a scary question, because if that plane, and I don't know where it is either, but if it got taken away somewhere, what happened to the people on the plane and who did it? And then, oh my God, what is going on? So it's a lot of a fear, and that's why as well they always like to make it the world look as like crazy as possible on the news. Every day something bad happened. Keep people in a state of fear, because that also keeps them from wanting to know this information.
Well, I think fear, first off, is a mind killer, and that governments over the span of human history have known this. And all I've ever seen, looking at history as a forensic historian, is people playing tricks on other people to steal their freedom. People playing tricks by hiding information, occulting it, useful information, information that you need to be free, information about yourself, about your environment. And if they can block those two things, they can pretty much take over how you think and how you react and have control. And that's what they need, because governments over time, again, have proven to be unable to control individuals. That's why the school system has to take all of our unique shaped pieces of dough, for lack of a better term, and stamp it into a cookie cutter shape that they can manage. They're like, let's cut off all these rough, unique edges that make you an individual. Let's just make you another cog, you know, another brick in the wall. So there's these ideas, but fear is the place where we can all relate, because we all experience fear. There's a lot of things I do just because I fear if I do that, they're going to put me in a cage. Oh my goodness, fear is controlling all of our lives. That's why people pay taxes, school taxes, federal taxes, state taxes, gas taxes, cigarette taxes, because they're scared of what happens. Well, when you get into the obedience to authority, well, fear is a very useful tactic for obeying authority. What could we use fear for? Well, we could use fear as an invitation to learning. Every time that they want to make us fearful, hey, let's just dig into that and learn a little bit about that. And what you'll find is once you familiarize yourself with the individual parts, how they fit together, and then how to take action in a predictable way consistently, then you lose that fear. You're turning it into knowledge. And that's what our minds are for. That's what the education system should be, but it's not education, it's schooling. It's taking these individuals and making them all think alike. And I think as long as parents keep sending their kids into a system that they're forced to pay for, that these kids are forced to go to, and that are run like Pavlovian or Skinnerian experimental labs that are degrading our ability to have any sort of intellectual capacity or attention span in this country whatsoever. One of the articles last week, I mean, it's really scary to me. I have built up a long attention span, so I can read an article and process what it means. And it says that the average smartphone user in the United States has a shorter attention span than a goldfish. That's less than 1 second. So realizing this ever-increasing trend to chop up everyone's attention span, I've purposely over the past decade created expansive presentations that encourage people to start using your time in a new, creative, and substantial way that yields you long-term benefits throughout your life in the form of understanding what's going on and therefore how you can be more successful and get to the goals that you have for yourself.
Yeah, there's a, you know, I was just thinking, like, sometimes I'm talking to somebody and I'll say something that, you know, a bit of truth. And after a while, sometimes they'll go, I don't want to know. And to me, I just don't get that. I want to know everything. I'm curious. But again, it's sort of fear-based, because if everything I'm saying is true, they have to rethink everything they thought about the way the world works. And to many people, that's very scary. And so, but the problem with that is that, reality has consequences. So you can ignore reality, but you can't ignore the consequences of ignoring reality. And I think that was a really good quote. So I think it's just really important that people realize that by ignoring reality or by just blocking yourself off from new information and not trying to learn, it's very dangerous, not only for you, but for everybody. Because if there's enough of these people, they allow all these huge things to be built up all around them that are very bad. Like you're pointing out, the police state that's growing up all around. And you've also pointed out about people's attention span. I'm constantly shocked at how short it is in terms of even like years as well, right? Because I write about finance at the Dollar Vigilante, and I'll bring up, hey, this looks almost exactly like how 2007 looked. And you guys remember 2008, right? And a lot of people are like, I remember there was something. I remember, yeah, there was like, I guess they said on TV there was a recession. It's like, oh my God, they don't even remember like 7 years ago.
Yeah, and that was a prime loan and mortgage crash. I mean, and then they had to cover it up with a tarp. And where I come from in the Midwest, that's what you use to cover up something valuable that you don't want to be seen by other people. You might put it on a tractor. In their case, they put it over a pile of billions and trillions of dollars. That it's just indenturing the future. I mean, the national debt enslaves the future. I don't understand why we're doing this. I mean, I saw the charts in your video this morning about the Shemitah. If you just look at the chart that's going up exponential, it's like, you know, the dollar's losing value. Things are getting out of control. People have let criminals at the hands of a printing press that, you know, 300 million people in this country, in the world, was using as an international currency. And I think after 10 years of letting criminals, it's like they're not just running these counterfeiting presses, you know, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. These guys are running it full time with the derivatives trading and the short selling, the naked short selling, the deep capture of the markets. I mean, there is a full spectrum plan to rape and pillage and plunder all the value that all of our ancestors in all these different countries have built up to this point. America at one point was a kind of a shining beacon for freedom as long as you weren't a slave. The original version of the Declaration of Independence, written by Thomas Paine, check out a Peace Revolution episode on that. included a clause that would have abolished slavery in the Declaration in 1776. But slave owners were going to sign that, and they couldn't have that. So, look, these things have been trying to peek their head out. Freedom. Freedom's trying to pop up all over the place. And Hegel said at a certain point that governments were going to be obsolete because the individual nature, the true individual nature of a human being is to be free. Okay. And so governments know that they've had a good scam and that it's kind of going out of style, and people are starting to figure out, hey, why do we need electoral college and all these people in between us? We have the internet and, you know, Tor. Can't we just vote for ourselves in a secure way? Couldn't we actually have our vote count for something? Well, no, not when you have a government that's basing everything on monopoly of force and basically a white collar form of slavery for everybody. I don't think that's going to work. So it's only in discovering these things for yourself that they exist, that you are part of it until you understand how not to be part of it. And then you can decide on your own if you want to communicate it verbally or, you know, or start writing books or create some sort of media to let more than just the other people that you come into direct contact with know about this, or just share things on social media that would help lead people toward a life without rulers, a life without slavery. I believe that people, you know, you should be neither above nor below, that there should be neither masters nor slaves. But until, you know, a couple billion people get that idea as something that they might want, it's not going to happen. And so it's through, you know, all of us kind of every now and then shooting our mouths off and saying, hey, there's a bunch of history that you might want to check out instead of watching the latest American Idol or the latest football or hockey or basketball or baseball game. You know, those things are short, and you're not going to get a whole lot of value after that game is over. But you could learn something in those same couple hours that is valuable to you for the rest of your life, that will empower yourself, your friends, your family, and generations to come if you do it right. So that's why I've been investing my time in the past decade into discovering that which exists that does have cause and effect action on our daily lives, and help to understand the institutions that are behind all these machinations so that we can become free as individuals, learn to think for ourselves, and then hopefully inspire others to do likewise.
Yeah, and I've said that for a long time, that it's so important to have programs like yours, Tragedy and Hope, things like James Corbett, We Are Change, Luke Radowski, Press for Truth, and literally hundreds of others, so that we can get others of types of information that we don't normally have access to. And but until people, it's amazing to me, like even watching Greece, what happened there, that happened 7 years ago, and everyone acted like they were shocked that happened in Greece. Like people were not expecting it. It was like the day, the weekend when they said they were going to close the banks, right as soon as they said they were going to close them, that's when people started going and lining up for the ATM machines. It's like, nice job. You just totally did it the wrong way. You're supposed to go before they close the banks. And people are acting like, you know, pensioners, you feel bad for them, but it's like, oh my God, how do you not know? Like, I knew they're going to do that. So how did you not know? You live there.
They got their safety deposit boxes raided. People who wanted to go on vacation in Greece, like if you were going there on your honeymoon and you paid $5,000 to go there and there's a resort, the government just took your money and you got there and there's no reservations. So it's a good learning case. Unfortunately for Greece, for us, it's a case of what happened there and how do we prevent that from happening in our country? Because we're in a much more precarious situation than Greece is. We're in a much more precarious situation than Puerto Rico or Spain or any of these other countries that are having these sorts of issues. So we have to take it a lot more seriously, because if America's economy collapses all at once, I mean, that's going to just send shock and turmoil all over the world. That doesn't need to happen. Doesn't need to happen. But the correction is the difference between what they're telling us and what reality is. And that's what the correction will be. And if they've been lying to us a lot, guess what? That correction gets exponentially bigger the more and more that they BS the story. And when you look at the national debt graph, that should tell you where the story is going right now. So I wouldn't recommend holding paper money. I wouldn't recommend Federal Reserve notes. There's cryptocurrencies, there's gold and silver and things like that. Check those things out, because if that electronic market crashes, you've got something at least to feed your family with, or to barter with, or, you know, make things that are useful to other people. That's another good way. Agorism, things like this. But the Greece situation, man, they started on austerity in 2011. So that's been going on for a long time. The debt they owe, it goes way back to World War II, because they were forced to loan the Nazis money. But then after the Nazis lost, the Nazis are like, we don't have to pay you that money back because we lost to the United States. So we owe them money, but we don't owe you money. And then the World Bank and the IMF. And guess what? If you go in and check out who created these organizations, it's the same people that funded the Nazis. They came in and said, hey, we can now be the international corporate gang bankers. And they they have done so successfully. And you know, you can look into John Perkins, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, or his recent book. There's a ton of information on this out there, but you're never going to know it for yourself. You'll always be believing somebody on this side of the screen unless you start to look. And there's this thing called Google and Wikipedia, and you can get into the references on Wikipedia, and you can start to see, oh, these guys that created the IMF and the World Bank, oh, who you know, there's some of these guys, John J. McCloy, he was sitting with Hitler in 1938 in Hitler's box at the Olympics. You know, he was a financier right up to the Harrimans and the Bushes and the other people who funded the Hitlerian establishment. I just did a 7-hour interview with this ex-Nazi hunter named John Loftus. I flew to Florida about a month ago now. I haven't got a chance to edit the footage yet because there's a lot of footage, and I went to Porkfest and that caused more footage. But John wrote these books about his experiences as a special. He worked for the Office of Special Investigations for the Department of Justice as an attorney. So he had what's called cosmic access. It's a security level access that gave him access to British and American and NATO records from World War II forward. So what he shows in his numerous books is that, the way that Israel got approved by the United Nations and got the votes they needed is that they blackmailed Nelson Rockefeller. Oh, that's interesting. Why did they blackmail Nelson Rockefeller? Oh, because they had found out that Alan Dulles, who is Nelson Rockefeller's attorney, and Nelson Rockefeller and a whole bunch of other people were funding the Nazis during a time of war. So anyway, there's 7.5 hours of really interesting question and answer into all these different cases of the Cold War, all the way up to the War on Terror and the origins of the Muslim Brotherhood and the Mujahideen and Al-Qaeda and the British influence that created Saudi Arabia. It was a British spy that set up Saudi Arabia and was the advisor to Ibn Saud his whole life. So once you start to get this other section or these other pieces of the pie, like in school, they might have given you a piece of pie, and that piece of pie had a bunch of bites out of it. I'm saying you can go get the rest of the pieces for yourself, put it together, and you can win at the game of Trivial Pursuit.
Yeah, it's amazing how many people just don't think about these things, and
but they could. That's where the hope is. Because I think people could learn. You know, it doesn't happen all at once for people. Not everyone's going to get it at the same time. But it's any time that people just have that spark of consciousness that asks a question and says, "Well, you know, what is it about this? Let me start looking." And you're going to find yourself down, you know, years later, down a miraculous road, because you don't realize all this stuff in one day. It's a journey. And every day I feel like I learn more than I did the day before, which keeps me humble, because if I'm learning so much every day, I must not have known much yesterday.
Yeah. just looking at Greece, what's going on there, like if even a small percentage of the population owns some gold and silver coins and owns some Bitcoin, this crisis would have been nowhere near as bad. They'd almost could ignore it, because that would just start to trade as money in the economy, and they'd be like, yeah, keep your euro, it's a piece of crap anyway. But people just don't open their eyes to what's going on. And you pointed out that I think there's definitely going to be a financial collapse coming in the US, and I just did a video on it, and I think it's really important. We'll put a link to it down below, called survivingshemitah.com, and you can also find on YouTube Shemitah Exposed, and we'll have links to that down below. But we can almost avoid a lot of these crises and disasters that are going to happen. These systems are in collapse, by waking people up so they'll be more prepared. And that's what this video that I did is all about, is get prepared now, because it's coming to the US soon, maybe as soon as September, but if not September, very soon after that, in my opinion.
Well, I think if you look at the longer charts of the stock market activity, you have the busts and the booms and the crashes and, you know, the bears and the bulls, and they're fighting. And it's just a graph that goes up and down like this. Well, to me, it looks like an engine shifting through gears. Okay. And so the 7-year cycle that you talk about in the Shemitah is something that is there to be checked out. And you can, you know, decide for yourself, watch the video, check it out, consider the history, do some looking up on your own. But the worst case scenario is that you find yourself, oh, nothing happened and the market didn't crash. Okay, well, it's going to crash at some point, because it's based on a bunch of illusions that are going to go away as soon as people realize, what does that mean that they're counterfeiting stocks? Oh, they're circulating a bunch of stocks that are getting to you and your friends and family and people who are trying to retire, and this is your retirement account. You think you own these stocks, but you don't own the paper. And the depository trust company, they have all the stocks. They got all the records. So sometimes you might go to cash in a stock at a time other people are trying to cash it in, and they say, well, you don't actually own that stock. That's going to start happening all at once. It's a game of musical chairs. It's the same with the currency. They're printing electronic currency as much as they're printing the paper currency. They're not, you know, there's no connection with reality. The wheels of the cart have left the path. So it's going to be a bumpy ride. But what can people do to garner against it? Well, if we weren't so based in a terrarium mentality, you know how if you got a pet, you might create an artificial ecosystem for it and provide it some state welfare, water, food, stuff like that, right? They keep us in cities and suburbs like pets. And we've gotten away from the self-reliance and the self-esteem that comes from being self-reliant and the know-how to actually invent and create and be an entrepreneur and to be able to figure out problems using a consistent method every time you face a problem instead of creating an ad hoc solution every time you're fearful, confused, flustered because something came up that you didn't know about. Well, guess what? That's life. We should have been prepared at a very early age with a method that helps us address those fear, those fearful, confusing, frustrating moments in life and say, what is the method to find out and start to get the learning? Oh, what are the individual parts of this thing that's confusing or frustrating or scary? And once you start thinking about it, that's how you get out of those ruts. That's how you overcome obstacles. That's how you overcome challenges. That's what America used to be about pre-Civil War. Ever since then, pretty much ever since 1814, the British have sought another way to undermine American freedom and ameliorate it back into the empire. And this has been a strong agenda in the past 100 years. You might think the British Empire doesn't exist anymore, went away. You would be foolish to think that because they have such a stranglehold on our intelligence and foreign policy that for people with no power, they sure can control a lot of people across an ocean over here. I mean, it's crazy how in bed our intelligence agencies are with the GCHQ and MI6. I mean, it's the Anglo-American establishment. They merged. They had a plan to merge in World War I. They got it done in World War II. And ever since then, we have not been the sovereigns of our own country because we've given away that power from becoming welfare state driven. This is an invention of the British system, British class system in like 1925 or 1934. You'll have to look that up for some certainty. But the welfare system is not our idea. And the fact that FDR brings that in and says, hey, we're going to start doing these things, that's a way to get people dependent on the state. Well, guess what? The more you're dependent on the state, the less you're free. If you're working several months a year to pay taxes, guess what? That's several months a year that the state is your master. And you might be free after you pay those things. And this wasn't the way the country was set up. These are things that came in while people were working hard and trying to raise their kids and out there trying to live their lives. These things were done in dirty dealing meetings like at Jekyll Island that G. Edward Griffin talks about and several, numerous. Bretton Woods in 1944, if you want to get back to the IMF World Bank in Greece. It's these types of meetings that go on, like you and Luke going to Bilderberg in the G7. That's why you guys have to go and cover meetings like that, because those people are making decisions for billions of other people who don't even know they exist. And I argue that you can't resist something that you don't know exists. But those things are out there having an adverse effect on us. And until we learn about them and get over our fear and discover that any one of us can take the actions that lead to change, then, it's a work in process. But, I think we all try to get up every day and better ourselves through that process.
Yeah, and it's amazing how so many people are asleep, and we saw that in Greece. It's just totally asleep. They didn't know there was going to be a crisis. It was in the news for like 3 months, and that's not even the real news. And so people just by not waking up, they cause a lot of their own problems, really, because they allow all these things to happen. If they were smarter or thought about things, they could maybe stop them in one way or another, but they don't. And then a big collapse happens, either caused by government or central banks, or there's wars, and people get all angry at the government. Like, you have to do something about this crisis or this, these problems we have. It's like, no, you personally have to do something. These people are not going to be helping you in any way. You have to learn for yourself and actually seek information and don't just, that box that most Americans watch, what is it? Something like 5 hours a day is not.
I think it's up to 8 hours a day of screen time, of actual screen time. It might even be higher than that when you consider people at work and smartphones and stuff like that.
I'm sure they're not watching like your documentaries and stuff on there either. They're watching American Idol or football. I like football, but once a week or something for a couple hours, relax. But it's not something I would watch 8 hours a day every single day.
Well, I think they just want to keep people misdirected. It's bread and circus. I mean, it's the same tactic that the Roman Caesars were using to control the population. As long as they give you Tom Brady's balls or, you know, the next Kardashian, whatever, Bruce Jenner, Caitlyn Jenner, you know, this whole sort of thing that goes on out there, it's just distracting. It's like it has nothing to do with most individuals, and yet it becomes media sensation. Donald Trump said some words. Oh, okay. We should all care about them. Now we're going to hear about it for weeks at a time. It's like, wait a minute. If I was given access to all the information that exists in the world, is that something I would choose for myself that I want to know about? Certainly not. So why is it that I can't go outside my house without seeing newspapers and people on TV and all these, you know, people on the street talking? Why do we allow ourselves to be like robots being, wirelessly controlled through these mechanisms instead of following our individual agenda? You could read something like, I don't know, the official Senate report on CIA torture. This is something I just got. This is a good one. Operation Gladio. The Americans and the British have been sponsoring terrorism for like 60 years and still ongoing. So it's like you can do your own programming by reading books or, you know, using the internet to your advantage. You could watch some commercial free educational programming on tragedyandhope.com. Or if you like audio, you could listen to Peace Revolution. That'll take up a good bit of your time.
Yeah, and that's part of their sort of their plan too, is to keep people just working so they don't really have time to look into things. And so a lot of people will just get home after 12-hour days at their job and just turn on the TV and watch American Idol because they're just exhausted, or they got, you know, and both the husband and the wife have to work now almost always because the central bank inflation over the last 100 years has really reduced the total value of what people make. So it used to be mostly in the U.S. just the man would go to work and the woman would stay with the kids, and now they can't because they've been so impoverished by the central banks and the taxes and the regulations.
Well, but with the, you know, the freedoms that still exist, we could become entrepreneurs and you could homeschool and the kids could learn from the family business. There's all sorts of things that can be done. But I empathize with people who want to just come home after a long day of work and veg out and not have to think about this stuff. The cool thing is you can still do that because you can listen to a podcast on the way to work and on the way home from work. Maybe you watch a couple videos over your lunch hour, and on your days off on Saturday while you're cleaning the garage or doing whatever around the house, you put on some stuff that's educational that you're going to start picking up and thinking about, because then you're going to feel less like watching American Idol, because you're going to wait, you're going to say, I'm going to get nothing for that 30 minutes or hour or whatever of time. But if I keep listening to this history of philosophy audiobook, I'm going to learn about truth and the nature of truth and how some people try to use words to obscure truth. I mean, if in the beginning there was the word, and the word was used to deceive people and make them believe things that weren't true. I mean, I see most of the folly that goes on in the world from people believing things that are not true and then taking action based on those beliefs in large numbers. And so if we could just kind of break that up a little bit, but it's not my place to tell anyone else what to do. I just let people know these things exist and you can check them out, and they're kind of interesting, and it's more interesting than what they're showing us on every other channel out there. So.
Yeah, for me personally, I've been doing that for decades. I rarely watch TV or movies unless they're really, really good, and unless I really think I'll like them, like Hunger Games I liked, and Matrix and Lord of the Rings, all these sort of all based on V for Vendetta, all based on freedom to certain extents. And so besides that, though, if the other night, for example, I'll just give an example. I was I had been working like 15 hours that day, and I said, I have to get away from the computer and I just want to just veg out. So I'm going to go watch something on Netflix. And I went up to my room, and but I didn't look for any movies. I looked for documentaries, and I just watched a documentary on Steve Jobs, which I found really interesting. And it taught me a lot about how he was able to build that company amazingly, despite numerous crazy circumstances. So even when I'm relaxing, I'm still learning. And I just find that just so much more enjoyable.
Well, I think freedom's a lifestyle. And that once you start getting out of the lifestyle of slavery and the lifestyle of servitude, and once you stop seeing the rope that we're throwing over the wall as a threat, we're not trying to hang you with the rope. We're giving you the rope so you can climb up and over and see some freedom. Because they're not showing it to you any place that, you know, most people, if you don't pay attention and consciously direct your attention and focus throughout the day, you're not going to bump into meaningful, substantial items that will lead you to freedom. They've got that whole media market monopolized with a bunch of BS, filming anybody doing anything except showing you how to think for yourself, learn about your environment, communicate with other people, plan your time, and be able to solve conflicts without violence. They don't want people knowing about that. That's why there's Porkfest and Anarchapulco and these other events that are held by individuals who see a need for change. And instead of complaining about it and waiting for someone else to do it, we decided to take it upon ourselves and kind of do it ourselves. We do it with the help of a lot of friends. And, you know, if it wasn't for friends and other people with likewise, you know, sharp acumen of freedom, there wouldn't be a reason to continue doing it. If it was the Borg and it was all taken over and I was the last one, then maybe I'd go with them. But right now I see tens of thousands of people at any given time through all these different social media networks that are checking out pieces of media that are leading to freedom. And if they keep checking those things out and passing them around, it's going to be more and more. It's like Larkin Rose's tiny dot. And my question was always, how do all those dots get all that information? That's through media. That's how we're doing it right now. We're creating media that lets you know that these things exist. They're out there. They have cause and effect relevance. You could become conscious of them, use them to your own advantage in your life, and live a happier, wealthier life. No strings attached. You're in control of yourself. It's not about any type of puppetry.
Yeah, and even me doing these Anarchast interviews, I take some pleasure in them for different reasons, but one of them is definitely I get to talk to all kinds of people like yourself, and so I'm learning right now, even while I'm working. This is great. You said at least 20 things that I didn't know about, and now I know about them, and I can look into them for myself, and it's very interesting.
Well, and it's so, like, I liked your interview with Judge Napolitano. I remember I had sampled part of that in a Peace Revolution episode a couple months back, and so I loved, you know, first off, part of my job is not only reading the history that exists that is pertinent to the situation that we're all experiencing, which is ever-increasing tyranny in a place that used to be the beacon of freedom. It's being able to look at my colleagues and my peers' work to learn and grow from that, not only from their guests, but from your production value, or, you know, how Corbett is good at his audio and video creations, and his Federal Reserve film is masterful. But I can tell that it was created by an individual who was working with his friends and not a multi-billion dollar company, because those companies don't want you to know about the history of the Federal Reserve and Jekyll Island and the American International Corporation, which was the corporation formed by the guys at Jekyll Island. After they did the Federal Reserve, a couple years later, they set up this holding company, which they funded the Bolshevik Revolution, put railroads in China and Russia, and completely funded the Cold War. So the same people that were running those scams on us are the same people controlling our money system to this day. And I think that once we know about it and we get enough people who know about it, we shouldn't have to tolerate it anymore. Although on an individual level, yes, there's not much we can do about it except abandon that currency and use Bitcoin or silver or gold. But when there is, you know, a lot of dots that are in the know, we have a lot more power. And so I think that's why I create media. I think that's why Luke and Brett and Ernie and Donna and you and so many of the other great people I interact with in the Liberty community do what we do, because it's necessary. Nobody else is going to do what I'm doing. No one else is going to do what Jeff's doing, or Corbett, or anybody else. We're all, it's like a chorus. We're all contributing our independent voices in a way and covering area that each other doesn't really cover. And yet it all overlaps and interconnects in a fascinating way. So that's why I love what I do for the past decade a lot more than any job I ever did in corporate world.
Yeah, and I've said that again in the past. Like, if you're sitting out there and you want to, like, you know, help get this information out there, start up your own podcast, start up your own show, you know, because no matter who you are, you're going to be different than me or different than any of us, Richard or anybody. And some people are just going to like you more than they like us, and maybe a lot more, who knows? So then they'll be more open to the information. And so just do it in your own way and get the information out there. And I think it's happening. I think there's so many, and all those people you just mentioned, Donna and Ernie, Freedom Phoenix, Brett Vainott of School Sucks podcast. A lot of them, I think, are going to be coming down to Anarchapulco this year, which I think will be announced by the time this goes live. I've been busy this week. It's going to be February 19th, 21st of 2016, and that should be probably live by the time this video goes live. So hopefully you can make it down as well, and we'll just keep going on and doing our stuff and keep exposing people to the truth or at least information that you can look into for yourself. Don't just take it from us. So why don't you just finish up with anything you want to finish up on, and also let people know where they can go for your information on your website and on your show and anything else that you have.
Before I do that, I wanted to thank you for supporting the Free Ross campaign. I saw that you've got some tickets to Anarchapulco up there. So instead of buying those tickets, you could pay that money. The money goes to Free Ross. You get the tickets and you get to go to Anarchapulco. So I donated copies of the Ultimate History Lesson with John Taylor Gatto. And we've got a special line of t-shirts that's being created. I'm meeting with Lynn soon, later this week, and we're going to verify the designs and she's going to approve everything. But I want to put them out there so that we can spread it out in a wide mesh to get people who are interested to be able to contribute to the campaign and get something back that they like, other than the other things that we already have in the fundraiser. And as far as if you want to know, if you'd like to learn more, I produce a podcast. It's called The Peace Revolution. You can find it on iTunes, or you could find it at my website, tragedyandhope.com. And the website's named after a history book. You might want to check that out.
That's great. So that's been another edition of Anarchast, your home for anarchy on the internet. So if you like this video, like, subscribe, share, that's another way that you can just help get this information out there. Just click that little thumbs up button and all of a sudden more people will have that video show up on their screen. And if they click the thumbs button, then we get a lot more views and a lot more people start to wake up. So that's by watching, going to places like tragedyandhope.com or listening to many of our shows and sharing them. And don't be shy about it. We have to get people to wake up or it's going to be bad for all of us. And if we get people to wake up, it's going to be amazing. So that's it for Anarchast, your home for anarchy on the internet. Peace, love, and anarchy.
When you consider that you have to spend all your time basically unteaching what your kids just learned.
So not only must the government recognize natural rights, but the government can't disparage them. Unfortunately, the people in the government have a hole in their copy where the Second Amendment is, the Ninth Amendment, and the Tenth Amendment.
So, you know, this is not so saintly. I mean, you know, because he's got the reputation of favoring, ending slavery. But he wasn't an opponent of slavery. The abolitionists were opponent of slavery, but not Abe Lincoln.
I mean, the actual argument and the explanation is pretty darn simple. I mean, it's so simple as to almost be self-evident. I mean, things like self-ownership and the non-aggression principle, it takes about 3 seconds to demonstrate that government can't be legitimate.
Well, I think human beings have the right to shape their own reality. And that's what's been taken away from us. We are participating involuntarily in a system that shapes our reality for us. And the first step is to not allow that.
You're paying off your debt, you have to pay off your car loans, your mortgage, you have to maybe even live with your parents, and then you look back at your life and you did nothing. You never challenged yourself, you never experienced anything, you never lived your life because you kept doing what the machine told you to do.
From Acapulco, Mexico, this is Anarchast.